الحمد لله، نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره، ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلوات الله وسلامه وبركاته عليه. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا، يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن خير الكلام كلام الله تبارك وتعالى، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. ثم أما بعد، أيها الإخوة والأخوات، بارك الله فيكم، جاء في حديث في الصحيحين عن النعمان بن بشير رضي الله تعالى عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال: ألا إن في الجسد مضغة إذا صلحت صلح الجسد كله، وإذا فسدت فسد الجسد كله، ألا وهي القلب. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, there comes in a hadith collected by al-Imamain, al-Bukhari wa Muslim, al-Imaman, in the two collections of the authentic narrations by the Imam al-Bukhari and Imam Muslim. May Allah tabarak wa ta'ala have mercy upon them both. On the authority of the Sahabi radiallahu ta'ala anhu, al-Nu'man ibn Bashir. On the authority of the companion, may Allah tabarak wa ta'ala have mercy upon him. May Allah tabarak wa ta'ala be pleased with him. Al-Nu'man ibn Bashir, who said that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that indeed in the body there is a morsel of flesh. إِذَا صَلَحَتْ صَلَحَ الْجَسَدُ كُلُّ. If this morsel of flesh is upright, if it is sound, then the rest of the body, the rest of the limbs will be sound as well. And if this morsel of flesh in that body is corrupt, then the rest of the limbs and the rest of that body will be corrupted. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, indeed, that mudgha, that morsel of flesh, it is the heart. Brothers and sisters, barakallahu fikum, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in many authentic hadith, have mentioned to us and spoke about the issue of that morsel of flesh that is within our chest, known as al-qalb, or the heart. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, fi kitabihi al-aziz, in his book, Al-Quran, has mentioned in many ayat the issue of the heart, mentioning that some hearts are hearts that are sound, some hearts are hearts that are pure, some hearts are hearts that contain light, and some hearts are hearts that are dark, hearts that are hard, hearts that are corrupted. They are hearts that are soft. They are hearts that are inclined to the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and are not heedless. And then they are hearts that are not inclined to the remembrance of Allah, are not inclined to that which has come down of the truth, are not inclined to following the sunnah of Al-Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and there are hearts that are drowned in ghafla, drowning in heedlessness. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala has mentioned about His remembrance Al-Quran, and mentioned about His remembrance, the revelation that has been sent down from the heavens. That this is a revelation that causes not only hearts to become humble and submissive, but even things that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala has created like mountains. As Allah tabarak wa ta'ala says, وَلَوْ أَنزَلْنَا هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ عَلَى جَبَلٍ لَرَأَيْتَهُ خَاشِعًا مُتَصَدِّعًا مِنْ خَشْيَةِ اللَّهِ. That if we would have sent this Quran down upon a mountain, then you would have found this mountain, you would have seen this mountain humbled and submissive due to the fear, on account of the fear of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, the awe of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. What more than can we say about something that is a morsel of flesh that can be squeezed, that can be squashed, that can be damaged very easily, physically, in comparison to this mountain, that if the remembrance of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, the Quran was revealed and sent down upon it, that it would humble itself and submit itself and fall down out of awe of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, speaking about Bani Israel, ثُمَّ قَسَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ ذَلِكَ فَهِيَ كَالْحِجَارَةِ. And then their hearts after that became hard, after Allah tabarak wa ta'ala sent down to them the ayat, sent to them their messenger, showed them all of those ayat, showed them all of those miracles. ثُمَّ قَسَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ ذَلِكَ فَهِيَ كَالْحِجَارَةِ أَوْ أَشَدُّ قَسْوَةِ. That their hearts became hard after all of these things that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala did for them. Their hearts became hard like rocks, like stones, but rather even more severe and more harder than stones. وَإِنَّ مِنَ الْهِجَارَةِ لَمَا يَتَفَجَّرُ مِنْهُ الْأَنْهَارُ وَإِنَّ مِنْهَا لَمَا يَشَّقَّقُ مِنْهُ الْمَاءُ وَإِنَّ مِنْهَا لَمَا يَهْبِطُ مِنْ خَشْيَةِ اللَّهِ وَمَا اللَّهُ بِغَافِلٍ أَمَّا تَعْمَلُونَ. And from amongst these stones are stones in which rivers and springs gush forth from these stones. Stones in which fall down from the mountains out of humbleness and submissiveness to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. What so more can we say about the hearts? Barakallahu feekum, ayyuha al-ikhwa wal-akhawat. If that is not enough, speaking about something that is an inanimate object like a mountain, concerning the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and speaking about an ummah that came way before us, that many of us have no connection to whatsoever, how does this relate to the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? How does this relate to you and I? What did Allah tabarak wa ta'ala say addressing the people of the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? يقول الله تبارك وتعالى ألم يعني للذين آمنوا أن تخشى قلوبهم لذكر الله وما نزل من الحق. الله تبارك وتعالى, he says, addressing the ummah of Muhammad, so that we are not left out in this affair, has not the time come for those who believe in Allah, those who follow Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this last ummah, has not the time come for their hearts to become humble and submissive due to the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Al-Quran, وَمَا نَزَلَ مِنَ الْحَقِّ, and that which was sent down of the truth, that which came with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَلَا يَكُونُ كَالَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ مِنْ قَبْلِ فَطَالَ عَلَيْهِمُ الْأَمَدِ فَقَسَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ وَكَثِيرٌ مِّنْهُمْ فَاسِقُونَ. Has not the time come for those believers, you and I, that our hearts will become humble and submissive due to the remembrance of Allah al-Quran and due to the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what he came with, and that we will not be like those who were given the book before us. After time passed and they were heedless, after time went past and they were heedless of Allah, heedless of the remembrance of Allah, distracted by the things of this dunya, قَسَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ, their hearts became hard and many of them became people of fisk. Because of ghafla, because of letting time go past when you're not in the remembrance of Allah, because of letting time go past when you are not looking into the book of Allah, because of letting time go past when your tongue is not moist with the remembrance of Allah, you're not being reminded about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What is the result of that? Qaswatul qalb, hardness of the heart. Ibn Kathir rahimahullah ta'ala said about this verse, he said, أَيْتَلِينُ قُلُوبُهُمْ إِنْدَ الذِّكْرِ وَالْمَوْعِظَ وَسِمَاءَ الْقُرْآنِ فتفهمه وتنقاد له وتسمع له وتطيعه. He says what it means is that their hearts become humble and soft and inclined to the remembrance of Allah. At the time when they hear the remembrance of Allah, at the time when they hear the maw'idah and the khutbah, at the time when they listen to the Quran, that they submit to it, that they listen to it and obey it. This is what is meant بخشت القلب أو خشوع القلب. إمام السعدي رحمه الله تعالى he says فالقلوب تحتاج في كل وقت, that the hearts are in need at all times, not sometimes. في كل وقت, the hearts are in need and to ذكر بما أنزل الله, to be reminded about what Allah تبارك وتعالى has sent down, وتناطق بالحكمة, and to be reminded of the sunnah. وقال الشيخ رحمه الله ولا ينبغي أبدا الغفلة عن ذلك, and it is not befitting ever for us to be heedless of those things. فإن ذلك سبب لقسوة القلب وجمود العين, because that is something that is a means and a cause for the heart to become hard and the eyes to become dry. When was the last time you cried due to remembrance of Allah? When was the last time you cried due to hearing the Quran? When was the last time you cried over your neglect and your heedlessness and your lack of adherence to the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? When is the last time that we cried over our sins and our mistakes? The reason why we don't cry anymore is because of ghafla. The reason why we don't cry anymore is because our hearts are hard. The reason why we don't cry anymore is because we go days and nights without listening to the Quran, reciting the Quran, reading something that reminds us of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, أيها الإخوة والأخوات, a very profound statement connected to this verse. كما جاء في تفسير ابن كثير وتفسير الطبري, he says, ما كان بين إسلامنا وبين أن عاتبنا الله بهذه الآية إلا أربع سنين. Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu, the great companion of the Messenger of Allah, min al-awwaleen, from us the foremost and the pioneers of the Muslims, min al-sabiqeen, he said that it was not concerning the time span between the time that we accepted Islam and we submitted ourselves to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala bit-tawheed wa inqiyadu lahu bit-ta'ah. It was not a time span, the amount, between the time that we accepted Islam and the time that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala censored us with this ayah here, except 4 years. Except a time span of 4 years. Think about ourselves. Has not the time come, brothers and sisters, for our hearts to be humble and submissive to the remembrance of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala and that which He has sent down from the truth? أقول قولي هذا أستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروا إنه كان غفارا. الحمد لله رب العالمين وعاقبة للمتقين ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين كالمبتدعة والمشركين وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له إله الأولين والآخرين قيم السماوات والأرضين وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله أرسله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله. أما بعد, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, we live in a time when there is no doubt and no one can deny that it is a difficult time to constantly keep oneself in the remembrance of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. With so many mashakil wa shawagil, so many things that preoccupy us, so many things that are problematic matters that we deal with on a daily basis, living in a land of kufr, working with people that are disbelievers, that do not remind us of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, studying in schools and colleges and institutions, around people that do not remind us of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, ikhtilat, intermingling between the sexes, all of these things that are distracting us from the remembrance of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, working 8 and 9 and 10 and 12 and 16 hours a day, only to go home very tired, only to go home very frustrated, only to go home and want to just sleep and want to just rest, to get oneself together, to go out and do the same thing the next day, day after day, night after night, month after month, year after year, until we look up and we ask ourselves, where has the time gone? When was the last time I was able to sit and just benefit and allow my heart to be humbled and submissive and softened by the remembrance of Allah? In many cases, one Jumu'ah to the next Jumu'ah is not going to do it. So we live in a time when we are far away and disconnected from the revelation. We live in a time when we don't see around us the examples that we need to see that will encourage us and will increase us in our iman. So all of these things are things that no doubt we cannot deny. A time when knowledge is very scarce and the people of knowledge is very scarce. A time when so many things are affecting the Muslim Ummah to distract us from that ruh, from that very spirit of al-Islam, which is khushu', which is humbleness and submissiveness to Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, that soul of the deen, outside of those mere ritualistic actions that we do with our limbs. But alhamdulillah, Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, huwa al-aleem, هو الخبير هو الحكيم. الله تبارك وتعالى is the all-knowing. الله تبارك وتعالى له الخبرة. He knows and he's very well acquainted to the circumstances and the conditions of his service in every time and every place from the beginning until the end. And his wisdom is a type of wisdom that we will never be able to grasp and understand. And because of this and because of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala knowing these things and being very wise, knowing that we will live in 2017, knowing that there will be these things that we encounter in 2017, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala did not leave us to drown in our heedlessness and to drown and be overtaken by the hardness of our hearts. Rather, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala revealed a verse many, many years ago that will continue to be applied and adhered to, and a way for the Muslims to come out of that heedlessness. يا أيها الذين آمنوا كتب عليكم الصيام كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم لعلكم تتقون. Oh, you who believe, الصيام, fasting, refraining, restraint from those things that are lawful for you, normally has been prescribed for you, has been prescribed for you as an obligation, just as it has been prescribed and made an obligation for those people that came before you. Why? Anticipating that the outcome, when you complete this siyam for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and following His command, anticipating for you that the outcome of that will be because of your ghafla, because of the qaswa of the qawl, because of the distractions, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. Perhaps, and it is hoped, and it is anticipated, that when you come out of this month, your taqwa will have increased. And if you were not a person of taqwa, you would have gained taqwa, and you will be amongst the muttaqoon. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala has legislated this for us to help and aid and assist us. There's no Malik, there's no Rabb that would ever do anything like this for his servants or those who are subjected to him. وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلُ الْأَعْلَى لَيْسَ كِمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. But Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He is Ar-Rabb, and He is Al-Malik, and we are Abid, and we are Ibad, and He has commanded us to worship Him, commanded us to commit or perform this particular action of Ibadah, and not only has He mandated it, and made it an obligation upon us, and made it something that we are subjected to His punishment and His anger if we do not fulfill it, but He has also aided and assisted us in doing it. He has given us every single thing that we need to gain the taqwa of Him. And what is one of those things? As-siyam, shahr Ramadan, shahr Ramadan. Fasting the month of Ramadan. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He says, إِنَّمَا يَتَقَبَّلُ اللَّهُ مِنَ الْمُتَّقِينَ. That Allah only accepts the deeds of the people of taqwa. So in order to be amongst the people of taqwa, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala has given you something that will aid you and assist you. 29 or 30 days of a guaranteed prescription that if you fulfill it, there's no doubt about it, you and I will be amongst the muttaqeen. No doubt about it. If you follow the prescription as Allah tabarak wa ta'ala has prescribed, and you follow the prescription from the doctor that He has sent, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there is no doubt that at the end of these 29 or 30 days, your heart will not be heatless, your heart will be soft, your heart will be clean, your heart will have light, and you will be amongst the people of taqwa. And we need to recognize this and understand this and believe in this and be certain about this and have no doubt whatsoever. Because how is it that many of us, or many of the people amongst humanity in general, if someone guarantees them and someone tells them that at the end of this month you will have lost 20 pounds, you would have gained 10 pounds of muscle mass, you have completed this program to put you on the road of success in your business, you have completed this program to put you on the road of success in your education, and I guarantee you that, which they cannot guarantee you that. Not only can they not guarantee you this success at the end of those 30 days, they cannot guarantee you the next 30 seconds of your life. Yet we will follow this. We will buy into this. We will believe this. We will follow those instructions from A to Z in order to achieve the outcome in this dunya affair. What about the spiritual life? What about the akhirah? What about what Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, wa man asdaqu min Allahi qila, and who is more truthful in speech than Allah? 29 to 30 days, He guarantees you will be amongst the people of taqwa, provided that you do it in a manner that has been prescribed. You cannot get a better guarantee than that, brothers and sisters. So as this month of Ramadan approaches, begin to prepare yourselves. begin to gain a type of joy and happiness within your heart of the approaching of this Daif Kareem, of this noble guest. Prepare yourself spiritually. Prepare yourselves physically. Begin to change your routine and make arrangements with your jobs and your schools and everything that you need to do so that you can be successful during this month. This is something that we do not do. We wait until the night when the Hilal is sighted, and then we get into the frame of mind of Ramadan. But we need to start to speak to our employers, speak to our teachers, speak to our neighbors, speak to everyone that is around us that we come in contact with, speak to our employees, speak to our customers to let them know that Ramadan is approaching and I'm not going to be the same person. My routine will not be the same during this month. Things are about to change. We cannot stand late at night in prayer because we did not talk to our employer or we did not make proper preparations. Perhaps before Ramadan, many of us can take the whole month off of work with pay, provided that we respect and we honor this month and we understand the significance and the importance of this month. How many people have went to a colleague that works with you and told them every single weekend, every day that you want to be off, every day that you need me to work, I will work. But when Ramadan comes in, I need that whole month off. Or I need half of that month off. Or I need the last 10 days off to make itikaf, and I will work any overtime you need me to work for free. For free. Because of my love and my commitment to the deen of al-Islam and how much I need to become amongst the muttaqun, I will work for free in order for you to give me those 10 days of Ramadan at the last 10 days. How many of us have prepared our businesses to have someone to be able to run our businesses at least at the last 10 days of Ramadan so that you can make i'tikaf in the masjid or at least part of a day or part of a night? How many of us have understood that maybe we need to go to work 2 hours late in the month of Ramadan so that we can stand at night in prayer and we can get enough sleep at night and maybe after Fajr so I work extra hours so that I can come in late? This is the mindset of the believer. This is the mindset of the intelligent Muslim who understands the value of earning these blessings that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala has given them. Brothers and sisters, we are very intelligent, very cunning. We are very crafty when it comes to dunya affairs. We need to become that crafty and cunning and intelligent when it comes to maneuvering ourselves around this land of kufr when it comes to our religion. When it comes to our religion. And the admonishment as well for the sisters alike, that the month of Ramadan is not a month for you that all you do is clean and cook. All you do is prepare meals. From the time of the day early, you begin to think about what you're going to cook. La, this is something that you can do, but make sure that you devote some time for prayer, some time for dhikr, some time for reciting Quran, and don't make the month of Ramadan when you become a professional cook only. And we have to encourage our wives and our women to be like this. We need to encourage them to embark and to deeply pay attention to these spiritual matters that they need to help them in their days and their nights. Do not make your wife just a cook during the month of Ramadan, preparing the meals for iftar for the masjid. Rather, encourage her to read Quran. Encourage her to stand in prayer. Encourage her to make the sunnah al-rawatib when she's home. Encourage her to be in the remembrance of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. Encourage her to listen to the Quran. Listen to lectures. All of those things that will keep her reminded during this month. And do not just make her a maid. This is very important. So we ask Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala to allow us to prepare for the month of Ramadan. And we ask Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala to allow us to be amongst those who our hearts become soft during the month of Ramadan. Amen. And then we exit the month of Ramadan better than the way that we entered it. Amen. And we exit the month of Ramadan as Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala has intended us to exit as muttaqeen, as muttaqoon. We ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala to provide for and to take care of and to allow this month of Ramadan to be a month of Ramadan for our Muslim brothers and sisters who are outside of this land, in the land of the Muslims, that they are safe and they have security and they have that which they need to break their fast for their iftar and their sahur. We ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala to provide for them. We ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala to keep them safe. We ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala to give them security. We ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala to remove the bala and the fitin that they are suffering during this month of Ramadan, to remove it from them. Ya Rabbal Alameen, aqulu qawli hadha, astaghfirullah li wa lakum fastaghfiruhu. والله تعالى أعلم وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. أقم الصلاة.